So, welcome all to this popular elite talk by Dr. G. Bhanu Prakash Reddy, who is a senior principal scientist and scientist G at National Institute of Nutrition, Hyderabad. He has kindly obliged to give this talk to the young minds to elevate the minds of students about the genomics and what the omics is all about. And how to garner this particular genomics subject to the schools. So we sincerely appreciate his time. So over to you, sir. This is as a part of this Bioinformatics for School Children program. Thank you so much, sir, for your time.
Thank you,
Prashant.
I really appreciate and admire your efforts in encouraging the kids to take up science.
Good evening, all, both younger kids and older kids.
In a couple of minutes, I just want to see each one of you, if you can switch on your video and then say in which grade you are, so that we have a very, very friendly talk. It's not a popular talk, but just I would like to give some kind of, you know, presentation all about research. Why do we do? How do we do? And then it helps you know what is all about it. Then of course we can think about some genomics. I know Prashant is probably the bigger kid. Then can I see someone else here? Or if you could say in which grade you are and your name.
Hello.
Kushal, yeah.
Hello. Good evening, sir. I'm Kushal and I'm currently studying in class 12th, PPS Arkapuram, New Delhi.
Excellent. Great.
Yeah. Are we supposed to keep our cameras on?
No, I just want to see, and actually this presentation is good for plus one and plus two kids. Of course, 10th class. And even the younger ones, they can enjoy. Anil, Arvin.
Yeah, Prasan is my son.
I know him. And Kushal, I see Lakshmi Tanmay Teja. Can you switch on your camera and say hello to...
You can come over here and introduce.
Yes, Prasad.
Please come.
Lakshmi Tanmay Teja. You are in which grade?
Please come here.
Sir, I am in 9th class.
Wonderful. Prasad is in 10. Prasad, you want to say?
Yeah, I am from 10th class.
Okay.
Shailesh?
Good evening. I am going to have Prashant's.
Hi, Nana.
Good evening, Uncle. I am Bhavyasri.
Good evening, Nana. Bhavya.
Yes. You are in which grade? I am in 8th grade.
Wonderful. I know you are going to write a manuscript, and Basant is so much inspired by that. I think he also wants to write a manuscript. Okay, good.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah. Okay, I'll start now.
My friend is also there, who is in bioinformatics for school. She is at my place. She also wants to introduce herself.
Great.
Good evening, Uncle. I'm Sambhavi Mohapatra in class grade 8.
Good evening. Very nice of you. Okay, thank you. Yeah. Okay, so unless someone wants to say something, I will just start my presentation. I have made some slides for you guys. And you can stop me anytime when you want to ask me something. As I said, I will begin with basic tenets of research, or what I would call it as concepts. And principles of research. Then I will share with you some of maybe my research work or somebody else's research work. But anytime you just stop and then ask me something that you want to. So let us start with this circle. Imagine that whatever the knowledge so far this whole world has gained. The human knowledge is within this circle. Okay, then what do you want to do with this knowledge, and do you want to add anything more to it? Okay, let us say Now, how did we come here first? Okay, I said all the knowledge that we have put it in this circle. But how did we reach here? Let me show you. Let us start in a smaller circle inside. Let's start from your elementary school or primary school or upper primary school, where we start getting into some subjects like science, math, you know, etc. That's where we start understanding some amount of discipline, separate discipline, after your, you know, typical alphabets, writing, grammar and all that. Then we start understanding environmental science, math, etc., etc. So you imagine that smaller circle is the one that you started understanding what is, you know, natural science, what is mathematics science, etc., etc. Okay, then by the time you come to high school, you would also start learning little more about, you know, reproductive digestive system, or in mass you may have specialization like trigonometry, algebra, etc., etc. Or you even get into physics and chemistry, you have some laws, physical laws, thermodynamic laws, etc. Once you come to plus two or even beyond that, since you all, you know, below plus two, once you come to plus two, you decide to go for a specialized discipline, let us say biology or BPC we call it as, maths we call it as MPC, or some people may even take CEC, HEC, but since it is science, I would focus on science related things. But there is a combination of maths and biology also, that is fine. So this small projection is where you start getting into your specialization, whether it's biology, maths or a combination of it. Now, once you move from plus two to your, you know, higher level undergrad or postgrad, for example, in my case, in BSc, I have botany, geology, chemistry, because then I dropped all my maths, social, physics, etc., etc., which is supposed to be somewhere around this. Now I am here, let's say biology, geology, and biology we have geology, botany, and then a bit of chemistry. When I came to MSc, I again dropped botany, geology, all those things, and then I choose biochemistry. Okay. Now I'm done with my MSc also. That means by the time you reach here, it is expected, not always, but that's how it should work. By the time I complete my post graduation, at least in my subject, let us say this is biochemistry. You may be here in, you know, in genetics, you may be here in microbiology, you may be here in, you know, systems biology or bioinformatics. But I am taking my example in biochemistry. By the time I finish my master's, I am expected to know the knowledge so far happened at least in this area. It's good if you can have knowledge in other areas also, but many a times it's not possible for us to understand the entire this circle. That's how we, each one of us, will get into some specialization. Now let us say I have completed my MSc with biochemistry, so I am expected to, or people expect me to know that I have something so far known in this area. That means I reached the circle, whatever the knowledge that we have gained. Then what do I do now? Well, if I want to go into some other job and some other discipline, it's okay. Now I decided to do research. Let's say if you want to do research, what is that you are going to do it? Because you already reached the pinnacle or the already known knowledge of it. So then what else you would know here? You have already touched that circle. Now here what we do, the research is, you want to push this circle beyond the place where it is now. That is what we call it as a research. That means so far whatever is known, you understood. But now you want to add to it. When you want to add to it, you try to contribute something to the knowledge that is already known. Let us say when you contribute in a specialized area, in my case it is biochemistry, or in your case it could be bioinformatics, or in somebody's case it could be chemistry. In 4 to 5 years, I worked on something, I added some new knowledge to this one. That's why this circle got pushed a bit in this particular discipline. Likewise, everyone may add in every other discipline. Let me show you how it happens. So now we call it as a PhD. So sometimes that's why I put it here. My son Valsant always asks me, do I need to do PhD for me to do research? You need not to, but the way the system works, it is better. Otherwise, it's not that one has to have a PhD to do this. Not necessarily. Even anyone at high school level, or even at undergrads level or postgraduate level, if you want to push this circle, you are most welcome to do, and actually it is nothing like that. But our system works like that. Therefore, during my PhD or somebody's PhD, they do something new. Then what is already done, that's why they push this circle. Now we, for just our convenience, we call it as a PhD. Okay, but if you magnify that particular area, you see from red to green zone, you have moved. Now what happens? People look at you in a different way because you have added something to the knowledge of this world. No, that's why if somebody adds some knowledge, they are recognized and they are really praised. But again, if you come back to the circle, can you look at it? This push what you have done is a very small one. The reason is that the knowledge is ocean. You have knowledge in biochemistry, you have knowledge in chemistry, you have knowledge in physics, you have knowledge in economics. So the entire thing is here. In that whole thing, when you look at what you have added, it's a small portion or small fraction. But that is very significant because everyone keeps, you know, pushing this circle in their own discipline in a small niche. That's why this circle gets bigger and bigger. So both the things, don't forget to look at the bigger picture where you are, but at the same time when you magnify, you know that in that particular area you have done a wonderful thing. Now as I said, keep pushing this circle. That is what is the all the time research. That's why somebody can ask a question, oh, what the last 200 years we are doing research, how long we can do? We cannot put a stop there because we have to keep on pushing. I'll tell you why we have to do that. So this is what, why do we have to do this? First of all, why do we have to push this circle? Why do we have to do research? Particularly in a practical approach, research is done to solve a specific problem. Now you can ask me what problem, you know, we all have solved. I'll show you in the next few slides. So you know that there is a, in our country, in many areas, there is a drought. That means we do not have enough rains. But in drought areas, we want to grow our crops. How can you develop the varieties which can survive and grow in a drought area? Likewise, you know, all of a sudden in our country, or for that matter in the entire world, all of a sudden a new disease might crop up, like the way that we have encountered COVID. Then how do we solve this? So like this, you know, time to time we encounter.
Excuse me, sir.
Is it okay? Yes,
sir,
I'm audible.
Perfect, sir. But someone has got a question, please. I'm sorry. Yeah, please. Sir.
Please. Yes. Anyone?
Sir, your presentation is still in first slide.
Is this one? Maybe I need to find a different way to do this.
Yes, sir, it is visible now.
Yes.
Can you see the slide now?
Yes, sir. Yeah.
Okay, because I may have to find a different way. Because I am able to see either slides presentation or this one. Therefore, I did not realize that part. Yeah, whenever you think that, you know, then you let me know. Okay.
We could not see the previous slide.
Okay, let me go to you. I'm glad that you told me. Otherwise, you know, I keep moving. In a Google Meet, I don't have both the options to see where I am. And let me share once again. Anyway, it's a very, very cool and informal thing. We can again go back and see whenever you want. Okay, you tell me where were we and where you want me to start. Is that okay? Prash, you may want to help me because where I am moving. This one we are okay, right? I told you. Knowledge.
Yeah, sure, sir. Sure. I mean, you may start from the.
Guys, you had a chance of this slide, right? One of you must answer me. Otherwise, I would not know because my computer does not have both the options to see you and to give the slide.
Sir, you can continue from here.
Okay. So I told you, once you go to the higher degree, you would specialize. And then after the specialization, you are expected to know the knowledge in that given subject where you have specialized. So that's where you reach the cycle. Can you just see the slide?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Good. So I was telling you that, you know, now when you are done with highest academic degree, not the PhD, but either a master's or whatever it is, you are expected to know that whatever the knowledge you have done. But during the PhD, we try to push this circle, because that's the knowledge so far we have. Now during your PhD, or for that matter in research without PhD also, where you try to add some new knowledge to this area, and that's how you push this line a bit in this given area. Likewise, if everyone keeps doing that, no, this circle gets bigger and bigger. And this is where I think I was telling, why do we do research and why do we push this circle? This is to solve a problem. As I was telling, no, the problem can be anything. Let's say we have encountered a new disease, or we have encountered a problem in our agriculture where we want to produce high yielding varieties, or you want to produce, you know, with a minimal electricity maximum output, or you want to in place of fuel vehicles, you want to generate the electric vehicles. So you can think on whatever, you know, it comes to your mind. So, but these are all already known. But now you should think that, what do you want to add to this world? So this is where the research comes. Usually, research is done at this point, at least. Otherwise, you know, in about 100 years ago or so, because you are kids, I just want to share this with you. About, you know, quite a few years ago, research was done by two categories of people. One category of people are very affluent people, and they need not worry about their, you know, what you call day-to-day life. They are wealthy and they are rich, and they know they want to do something different. So they do crazy things. By doing that, they will discover something. Whereas the other category of people, you know, they are very restless people. I think they want to solve some problems or other. Like, you know, you take Newton, when he saw the apple falling down, either you or me, we would have happily slept under the tree. But he was not keeping quiet. Why did it fall down from top to bottom? It could have gone up. So that's where he started thinking like that. So this is, there are two kinds of people. That's how research used to be done. But nowadays, research is focused to get to some points, to do something to this society, that is nothing but for the welfare of the society, for the future of this society, to sustain this society. Now, I hope these concepts are clear to you guys. Otherwise, you stop me here. Then I will move to a little bit on the importance of the biomedical research, that are your bioinformatics is part of this one. Is that okay, guys? You got the concepts? Why we do research? What is research?
Sir, your presentation is still in the 11th slide. It is not moving further, sir.
In my computer, it is okay. I don't know what is happening.
I don't know why it's not moving, sir, but...
this is where I am.
Sir, I
would suggest you first turn off the screen sharing option, then turn it on again. Maybe there's some issue with your internet.
Okay, let me do that. I can even close the. Yeah, because this is very important for you kids. Okay. Sometime the technical glitches will not cooperate with this. Can you see this now?
Yes, sir, we can. So first try changing the slide. If we can't see the changing of the slides, then I think there's an issue.
Say it again, first one.
So try changing the slides, then if we can't see the changed slide, then I think there's an issue. Do tell us when you have changed it.
Okay, I'll do that now. Okay.
Yeah, if you can move down, sir, maybe we'll be able to know whether or not it's working. Yeah. Move down with an arrow key or something, keeping your...
I'm doing that, but I think there seems to be some... Okay.
Yeah,
yeah, this is the first one. This is the second one.
So
we still can't see it being changed. So,
okay.
So maybe you can leave the meeting and rejoin it again. That could help, I guess.
Okay.
Okay, let me do that.
Sorry,
then give me a second, I'll rejoin.
Yeah, I could see that second slide last minute, but you could try again rejoining, sir. Maybe that's a good idea, please.
Yes.
So
what actually happened was, I think the screen got frozen and then there's some issue.
Yeah.
Should I make it a slide, sir?
Yes, sir. Please. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
You can see it,
right? No.
No. Not yet.
How about now?
It's still in the slide mode, not the presentation mode, sir.
Oh, okay.
I can do that.
Yeah.
Yes, please. Yeah. Now, if you can move to the next slide, please. Yeah. Now it's clear, sir. Yeah.
Should I quickly say it again, or you guys got what I was saying?
So it would be better if you could recapitulate.
Okay, guys. So put up with me because it may be boring again. Okay.
Okay.
What I wanted to convey in the first few slides is that, you know, what is actually the concept of research and why do we do research? So I started with a circle, you know, the imaginary cycle, the circle, and to tell you that so far the knowledge that this human world has got, you know, is in this circle. So now we start from our school education, whether it's elementary or primary, upper primary, where we start with, you know, after alphabets and basic things, we start specializing in some science or math, physics, etc., etc. That is the small circle inside the bigger circle. Now when you come to 9th, 10th or so, where you know you will have geography, you have chemistry, physics, and biology, where you try to understand some specialized aspects like, you know, brain, how it works, and how reproductive system works, etc., etc. When you go up, whether it is a plus 2 or undergrad, where you try to choose this specialized area like, you know, biology or mathematics. Again, in biology, you may even pick up, you know, a major in biology like that. So that's where this specialization starts. Okay. Now, once you know, come to after undergrad, you know, postgraduate level also, where again we get into a much more specialized area. Let's say in undergraduate, during my period, it is called BSc. In BSc, I had botany, zoology, and chemistry. After that, I choose biochemistry for my MSc. That means now I dropped all other subjects. I am only focusing on biochemistry. By the time I am done with my MSc, as I was telling, in that particular area, in biochemistry, either me or somebody who has done MSc in biochemistry is expected to know the knowledge so far gained in that particular field. then what I want to do, or for that matter anybody wants to do at MSc, they want to do research, it is called producing a reading a paper and then producing something new. So what is that new? I was telling that is pushing this line. So far whatever we knew, that is already known. So there is nothing much you have added. So you, through your research, now you want to add something new to this line. When you do that, this line gets pushed. That means you have added to this circle something new that it was not known earlier. Right? So, but this is in a bigger picture, you are in a given area, it's a small contribution. But that small contribution, when you magnify it, it has got its own significance. Sometimes we call it as a PhD, because that's where you start your initial days of research. Now, I also told, when you add something new to this knowledge, you are highly regarded. Okay. So that is the first thing in the research, because that is the most satisfying thing for anybody, because you are one person who have added some knowledge to this circle of the knowledge. But when again you go back to the circle, the bigger picture, what you have added is a small fraction. But that small fraction is very important, because everyone keeps doing like this in different areas, in economics, in physics, in chemistry, in mathematics, everything. So this circle becomes bigger, and the knowledge getting accumulated.
Sir, can I present some of my views on research? Sir, as the name suggests, research, that means searching something that has been already existing and focusing on its finer details.
Wonderful. Yeah, actually, see, I should have made it clear in the beginning. Whatever we explore that and we bring it to the knowledge of others, it's already there in the nature. There's nothing that we create new. It, you know, the principles of science, they are already there in the nature. Only thing is, we did not knew that. Okay? So that's how, you know, the, when you say research, in one way you are right, searching the, you know, what is already like doing a research. But you know, this naming is very funny. Maybe Prash can add later. How do you want to really clarify search and research? But that's how we use this terminology, research. Because you are researching something on a known domain that is there in the nature, but you want to bring it to the everybody's knowledge, and in a form that can be utilized and that can be understood. Okay. For that matter, then the last, but exactly, gravitational force. Let us say that the gravitational force we have not created; we only understood it. Right.
Yes.
Yeah, for that matter, all the laws, thermodynamic laws, we have not created those laws. They work in the nature. But we understood them and we wanted to see whether they are useful to us or how can we use them. That's why we maybe know this terminology is like that. Can I move now?
Okay. Yes, sir.
Yeah, here I was, I think, you know, the reason why we do research or search is to find solution to the problems that are there in and around, or in our surroundings, in our neighborhood, or in our country, or in the world, for that matter, because science is global. Only thing is, it is up to you which problem you want to solve. The problem that is next to you, or the problem in somewhere else, it's your choice. But basically, research is done to find a solution to a problem. That is, problem means the way that you perceive as a problem. Because sometimes, you know, the problem also defined in a different way, as you ask me the question, search and research. So giving this basic principles of research, I just want to share some of the areas of biomedical research, because this is a bioinformatics and mix for kids. So let us start with something. What is the importance of biomedical research? So how do you define what is biomedical research? Biomedical research is the study of finding ways to maintain the health, or ways to prevent, treat and cure diseases that cause illness or sometimes death in people as well as animals. Most of the time people think that biomedical research is only meant for human beings. No, it's for all other animals, even the small creatures. Animals means not necessarily bigger animals. It is all the living beings. No, biomedical means anything to do with life. But since we give priority to human things, so that's how we pursue that biomedical research is only for people. But yes, it includes all. So therefore there are two, three names for this biomedical research. You can call it as a biomedical research, you can call it as experimental medicine, you can call it as a medical research, but more or less they are similar things. There may be no subtle difference between each of these terms, but whenever you encounter these terms, you can understood that it is something related to biomedical research. In for that matter, in any research, not only biomedical research, there are two, three again words people use. What is basic, called basic research, applied research, or translation research. No matter what kind of research you conduct, it is to gain the knowledge in the field of health and disease. That sometimes we can even say medicine. Whenever it comes to health and disease, it comes under the domain of medicine. But let me just elaborate little bit, not too much, that you know, this again basic research, we use different terminology, pure research, fundamental research. That means fundamentally you are adding something, fundamentally you are discovering something, the way that you know Newton discovered, the way Watson and Crick has discovered, you know, the way our immune system has been discovered. So fundamentally you will find something. So the research is carried out to increase the understanding of fundamental principles. It is not intended to yield immediate commercial benefit or applications. That's why we call it as a pure and fundamental research. That means at the time when you discover, you may know or you may not know what is its application. All that you understood that there is something like this works. So, but you know, in coming days, it may have applications, or sometime it may not even have an application directly, but indirectly it may help. So that's why these are the terminology. Pure research can be thought of as arising out of curiosity. That's what I said, no? In initial days, these days science is a profession, but you know, olden days there's nothing like PhD or MSc, BSc. People, you know, just out of curiosity, if you see the invention starts, mother of invention, if you call wheel, because how they want to move things in a smoother way, they found, you know, wheel is a better movement than the flat surface. So that's a curiosity. Then that can be put into application. However, in the long term, it is the basis for many, many commercial products or solving the problems. Whereas applied research and translational research, these are somewhat, you know, similar terms. There may be slight difference between applied research and translational research. Basically, you want to use the knowledge to solve some practical problems. Let us say applied research deals with the solving practical problems and generally employs empirical methodology. Empirical methodology means in a designed way that, you know, now you discovered the electricity, now you want to put into use in different formal ways. That's the empirical methodology. Likewise, you have, you know, discovered mechanical strength. How do you want to use that mechanical strength for many, many applications? Same way we have discovered, you know, the thermodynamic laws, but we have put into so many uses. Similarly, translation research is something like that, but you know, it is more applied in case of in medicine, particularly research or pharmaceutical companies for the benefit of, you know, human health. Translation research is commonly used in biomedical research because you want to apply the scientific research to make the research applicable to the population, I can say, for the larger population. That's why it is called translation research. This one slide, I want to tell you, like, you know, with the research, what all that we have gained. I'm only, you know, listing here the biomedical research, few things, not all. This may not even add to 10% of what is known, but some of the major things. Let us say, because of this fundamental concept that I mentioned, because of our curiosity or because of the formal research, we could discover vaccines for measles, polio, or many, many diarrheal diseases. And the recent one is that now we are talking about the vaccine for COVID. Likewise, we have developed insulin treatment for diabetes. So I don't know how many of you know this concept, but I'll tell you later. Likewise, we have developed antibiotics for treating a host of infectious diseases or maladies. Likewise, we have developed medication for blood pressure or many, many other diseases. We have improved treatments for AIDS. I still remember when I was in the school, maybe about 30 or 40 years ago, when AIDS occurred, if somebody with AIDS, people used to think that they used to isolate those patients and they were almost given up. Okay, this guy is going to die some day or the other. But today it's totally different. AIDS person can survive and be as normal as like any of us. And treatments for heart diseases, there are new surgical techniques and many successful treatments for cancer. Again, cancer, if you go back to 50 years ago, well, if somebody gets a cancer, it is like almost a given it. Like, you know, I think someday or the other, he or she is going to die. But today, once you detect the cancer, depending upon at what stage you detect, you can survive for the rest of your life with a proper treatment. So I can go on saying like this. But I want to highlight why do people spend years and years in biomedical research and what do we get? And most recent one is the genome editing and CRISPR-Cas. I think Prash and some of our friends may tell you later what is the CRISPR-Cas. CRISPR-Cas is nothing but like the way our either Word document or PowerPoint, where you want to delete one word and you add another word. It is exactly like that, you know, the your DNA you can do with this CRISPR-Cas. That means, let's say, now this sentence, treatment of heart disease is your genome. Now I can remove heart and put something here, kidney. So it's like the way that you type in your Word document, you can do that. Though, you know, not many labs in India may not be doing that, but there are good number of labs where we are in such a situation that this take advancement of research. Now, this is another slide for particularly the kids who want to enter into the research. There is always a perception that, you know, biomedical research as medicine means guys with only biology, they can go into the biomedical research. That is not true. Biomedical, who can do biomedical research? Yes, obviously biologists, physicians means doctors, chemists. Without chemistry, there's no biomedical research. Physicist, because all the physics laws that apply to the proteins that Prash and Sundarda, whoever tells you how the protein structure function works, there are a lot of physics is involved. And obviously, computer scientists, engineers. Then you ask that what engineers do in biomedical research? All the equipments that we call scanning, MRIs, ECGs, you know. Whatever the biomedical equipment you name, these engineers are required to do that. And then social scientists. You may ask that why social is connected to biomedical research. I'll tell you. Biomedical research has to know what is happening in the population, in the society, in the country. Where is COVID? Where is polio? You know, where is malaria disease? Because these social scientists will go and survey and tell us that, okay, in this particular area, this many people are affected. Then only people in the lab, they can think of how to solve this problem. Therefore, biomedical research means don't think that only biophysics and biology. Anyone can contribute to the biomedical research. Okay. Now I will take you to a few different slides. As I was talking, biomedical research deals with health and disease. I also want to give a brief outcome of, no, outline of what is this health and disease. So I will not read up all the definitions. The first one I will tell you, according to WHO, many of us think that health means without any disease. That's not correct. Health is the complete status of physical, mental, and social well-being. Please note this point. Social well-being is most important for the health. And not only just the absence of disease or infirmity, it is all the physical, mental, and social well-being. Therefore, a healthy person is leading a socially and economically active life. Now, what are the requirements for good health? We all know that good health is essential for leading purposeful life. You can define what is a purposeful life, but that's not the topic of today. For maintaining good health, following conditions are essential. Your good nutrition, what we call as a balanced diet, exercise and rest, good habits, etc., etc.
So, sir, is the BMI thing worth being considered for considering a person to be healthy? Because we find many people who are like bodybuilders and others who are really very tough and they have BMI over 25, which is the standard set by WHO. So we still consider them as the healthiest of the lot. So is the BMI thing which we consider that is the a healthy weight range right or wrong?
BMI is one of the indices or indicators in a health and disease parameters, but that's not the only thing. BMI is a body mass index. There's an index, let's say, according to our Indian population, the BMI between 18.5 to 23 is optimal. As you said, anything above that, we have different categories. Earlier it used to be 25, but for Asian population now we have revisited this range, and now we reduced to 23 because we are slightly, like, you know, in with respect to height and other body composition, we are different from Westerners, particularly US and Europeans. Therefore, our BMI is now up to 23. As you said, rightly said, either it's 23 or 25, above that, it is considered as overweight, and then above 30, it is obesity. So, which is an indication for not a optimal health condition. But there are different conditions in, again, obesity and overweight. There is something called healthy overweight and not so healthy overweight. That has to be judged by other factors. Okay? But certainly that is one indicator.
Okay, sir.
And remember, actually, lower BMI is also worse. Less than 18.5 means you are lean. Either, you know, for kids, we call it as stunting, or you are, you know, you are not up to the mark.
And sir, I used to earlier be a very skinny person. So, in the growing phase as well, is that thing valid? Because.
Yes, actually, in the growing period, that is very much valid. That's how we define stunting. Stunting means whether you are have optimal height for your given age. That is what is the definition of stunting. Let's say for a, you know, a 10 years old kid, there is a chart, you should have this much of height. If you lesser than that, you are stunted. Likewise, for a given age or height, you should have this much of weight. If you do not have that, it is called wasting. That means you are very thin. So, like, there are two, three other parameters. In a growing period, it is utmost important to have these parameters.
Okay, sir.
Okay. Now we will slightly move to the, you know, the area of your group, that is bioinformatics group, where, you know, the level of biological information is like this. You know, you start all the way from your nucleic acids, and then to proteins. These proteins in the form of networks, they produce metabolites, which these networks are called pathways or networks. They are part of the cells, because cell is the, we used to call as a unit of life. I don't know whether it is still valid or not. Prashant can tell us. And then, you know, organs are formed by the cells, and you have different kinds of organs, either brain, liver, you know, muscle, etc., etc. All of them put together, you get an individual, and individuals form populations, and populations are part of ecologies. Why I am showing this slide is that biomedical research, depending upon your solution, I mean your problem and what the solution you are looking for, you can work at any of these levels. Let us say I only want to know the structure and function of DNA, or that to a part of DNA. I only take this DNA or this mRNA, I keep working with this, I don't even go anywhere near to this one. But I want to work with cells, and then I want to know the how these networks are connected, how cells are working in an organ. I use either cells, I use either organs. But if I want to work with whole individual or whole organism models, I take some animal models or even human situations where I try to understand. So why this is very important for your systems biology and bioinformatics, because in systems biology it is connected, how the whole system is connected. Nothing works in isolation. Though I can take one protein and start working with its function and structure, but it, in isolation it doesn't exist. In biology, it works with the organs and the individuals, and it has its own place. That's what is called systems biology. And sometimes we, as a nutrition scientist, we work with the populations, and even in a bigger picture, as I said, the ecology includes populations. Now this is another one which you guys are talking about, the genomics. Now the third, the word omics is something in a given area. Genomics is complete genetic makeup of an organism. So you have different terms in genomics, whether it is transcriptomics, that means just the gene that is transcribed, the proteomics, the proteins, metabolomics, the metabolites, and epigenomics means beyond the already the genetic makeup that what we have, sometime it can get changed, that is epigenomics. But all these things, you know, are a huge amount of information. The bioinformatics is the one which handles this much of data, but I am not an expert, I don't want to go into this. I just wanted to show you this slide. For some reason I am going to have another slides where it will be helpful, but otherwise, you know, genomics is understanding the comprehensive analysis of a broad area. Let us say genomics of a person means entire genome you will understand, or in a, you can even these days people work at a single cell level also, but that's a different issue. Now this is another important slide for you guys, because this is what we call basic principle. Actually, this is the basic principle for the omic technologies. The reason is that you do omics at this level, that is nucleic acid level, DNA, RNA, or you do at a protein level, that is proteomics, or you do at a metabolites level, that is metabolomics. But we all know that in life we call this DNA to RNA, RNA to protein, and as a central dogma of life. Well, in some cases it may be the other way, RNA to DNA, but in majority of the cases DNA to RNA, RNA to protein, and then metabolism. This you may call it as the old terminology, that is central dogma of life, but in a different way we call it as a molecular fingerprint. That means this molecular fingerprint is unique to each individual, to each organism. Okay, you may say that okay, all human beings may have same thing. By and large, yes, they are same thing. But you know, if you are 5.6 inches, whereas I am 5.3, this molecular fingerprint determines that. In addition with the environment. Okay, molecular fingerprint is actually a dynamic process. As I said, it is it gets changes. It is influenced by environment. When I say environment, that includes nutrition also, because I come from nutrition institute. So this molecular fingerprint is the most important regulator of the life. Now I also want to introduce one more concept, that you know, our ancient concept, people say that you are what you eat. How many of you know that? At least at your home people will say that you are what you eat. That means our food decides our health or disease condition. But in a previous slide I told you, this is the one which decides our condition, this molecular fingerprint. That is nothing but our health and disease is decided by molecular fingerprint. Yes, both are true. If both are true, can we connect these two together? Let us say, yes. How food affects your health and disease? Through this molecular fingerprint. That is exactly what we in nutrition parlance call nutrigenomics. That means how your food affects your molecular fingerprint. Again, I go back to the molecular fingerprints is these molecules, nucleic acids, proteins, metabolomics or metabolites. So this is in a simple term is nutrigenomics. But again, I am not an expert in either any of the genomics, so I will not elaborate too much on that. I'll just show you a few things. So what actually the nutrigenomics or nutritional genomics. It's a generalized term. Like as I said, you can do any of those omics. It could be genomics, it could be transcriptomics, proteomics. But the question is how your nutrition or diet influences these omics. The reason is that human diet contains 20,000 different compounds. I repeat again, the diet that we eat comes with 20,000 different compounds. But of course, we may not know all those 20 different thousands. At least 50 major ones we know. Can any one of you name what are those 5 or 10 from the diet what we get?
Proteins, vitamins,
very
fat,
good.
Minerals,
yeah, excellent.
Carbohydrates.
Yeah. Great, great. That's what. Fatty acids, carbohydrates, proteins, amino acids, etc., etc. There are many more. Of course, carotenoids, some pigments, etc. Wonderful. So now you imagine from this 50, if you expand to 20,000, how these 20,000 compounds can influence our molecular fingerprint and then can influence our health and disease. That's exactly is the nutritional genomics or nutrigenomics. And we all think that, you know, proteins and carbohydrates, they provide energy and our building blocks. But apart from providing the substrates for generating energy, A large number of food components are bioactive. I'll tell you when I say bioactive and affect the genome. That's what I told you in the earlier pictures. The genome is affected by these bioactive compounds, whether at a transcriptome level or protein expression level. It could be directly or indirectly, but certainly it regulates the biological processes. And foodstuffs contain, as one of you rightly said, macronutrients. Macronutrients means we take in large amounts, such as carbohydrates, lipids, and proteins. It also contains micronutrients. Why do we call micronutrients? We take them in a small quantity. Sometimes it could be even micrograms, lesser than micrograms. That's why we call them as micronutrients. And they are basically vitamins and minerals. Either macronutrients or micronutrients that exhibit effects on RNA, protein, or metabolite level in a cell or organism when exposed to these food components. When I say when exposed to these food components means whatever the diet you take, what kind of molecules you have in the diet, that will regulate your molecular fingerprint. Therefore, there are These are two different terminologies I want to clarify to you people. There are two related terminologies, nutrigenetics and nutrigenomics. People get confused, even at my level or MSc level, people are not clear what is nutrigenetics, what is nutrigenomics. Nutrigenetics is the science of the effect of genetic variation on cellular organisms in response to dietary intervention. That means when you take some food, how that food has to be handled by in the individual is determined by your genetic makeup. That means your genome response to that food. Whereas nutrigenomics is the other way, how your food affects your molecular fingerprints. What I said earlier is this one, nutrigenomics. Whereas the other way also, let's say I take same amount of rice and you take same amount of rice, but your response to it may be different from that of my response. That means my genetic makeup is different, your genetic makeup is different. So it may be useful to have rice for you, but it may not be useful to have rice for me. That is what is the our genetic makeup, which determines response. That is nutrigenetics. Okay. Anyway, don't get too much complicated and confused by this one. Just to tell you that how these two are different. Basically, they are, you know, two sides of the same coin.
So, as we say that someone is allergic to something, for example, we say someone is allergic to maybe sugar.
Yeah, sugar.
Sugar. So, is it because of its the person's genetics that he shows certain response to sugar consumption?
Exactly. I want to your good name, please. I know I asked all of you. You are asking really good questions.
Sir Kushal.
Kushal, I'll tell you one example. There are so many examples. Lactose intolerance. Many people have lactose intolerance. That means some people cannot digest lactose. Lactose is a disaccharide. It has to be broken down into two monosaccharides by enzyme glycosidase. Okay. The enzyme that breaks this lactose, some people have a problem. Either its activity is low or some people may not have it. Therefore, those people cannot tolerate lactose. That's why it is called lactose intolerance. That's exactly what I showed in this one. This is what, you know, you take lactose, I take lactose, but I am able to tolerate, you are not able to tolerate, because my genetics is different from that of your genetics. That's why it is called nutrigenetics. Whereas I'll tell you, I take carotenoids, whereas you take all the time rice. Carotenoids are good for health. They influence our molecular fingerprint in such a way that it maintains good health. Whereas too much of carbohydrates, they are not good. They affect our molecular fingerprint in such a way that they make you obese. So this is nutrigenomics.
Excuse me, sir.
Please.
Sir, I have an example that I was allergic to pets. So, but when I was in interaction with the pets, this allergy reduced. So, why did this happen? It might be in my genetics, but it got cured.
What is the your allergy with the pet is, you know, the microbes that are there with the pet is a major thing. But sometimes, you know, the pet biological samples also, whether let's say some, most of the time the dogs, you know, the saliva or something, which is very rare, but by and large it is the microbiome that is associated with the pet is one that is the problem for many people who are allergic to this one. So that means your body is not able to tolerate those microbes. For example, as we are talking about the COVID only affects only 3%, whereas the, or let us say 30%, whereas the 70 people don't even have the symptoms. That means they are able to handle it. It's not that they are not infected. Even if they are infected, they are able to survive because their immune system is strong. Whereas some people immune system is not able to handle it because their antibodies may be low or whatever it is. In a similar way, some people, these microbes, they may not be able to handle it. Or other biological contaminants with the pet, either it is a saliva or the poo or something like that. How one individual has a reaction to this?
Good.
Okay. I was telling that how diet influences. As I said, diet could be protein, diet could be fat, diet could be carbohydrates, all many other micronutrients I told you, vitamin A, B, C, D. Some of these nutrients, they can influence your genome. At a nucleic acid level or at a protein level. So that's how this diet effect on genotype will show the response in terms of phenotype. Phenotype means whether you got the disease or not. That is what we call as a phenotype. In other words, health or disease. So in actually nutrigenomics, just to, because you guys are kids, I picked up the cartoon, some cartoons, instead of showing the typical research. Here is the cartoon. You have different kinds of foods. Let us say this is energy rich food where you have a lot of proteins and other things, whereas these are fruits, vegetables, which are, you know, greeny leaf vegetables, supposed to be good for your health. And this kind of foods, too much of, you know, burgers, sandwiches, high calorie foods, they can make you like this. So in nutrition research, what do? First, we try to profile what all the things that we have here. So how they are able to maintain your body like this. So we would try to profile their nutrients, and also we'll try to profile your metabolites, etc. Similarly with this kind of food, how you are able to maintain optimal health. Whereas if you take this kind of junk food, why are you becoming obese? Somebody asked me that, BMI about 25. So what makes this food? Because this ultimately turns into fat in your body. Therefore, we try to understand what kind of molecules are there in this kind of food and how they are affecting your molecular fingerprint. So if we understand, can we somehow regulate that? So, or can we stop that? Even if you are not able to stop eating this food, is there any way that we can regulate in between so that you will not become obese? That's I'm just in a concept level I'm saying. Okay, I will show you another cartoon. It is the same kid. Let's say either you or me. If you take this kind of food, you are going to be like this. If you take this kind of food, you are going to be like this. As I said, if you take this food, you are going to be like this. So now but it's not necessary that I want to tell you that. Sometimes some people have got a capacity to handle this kind of food, but they will not become obese. So that is very curious for researchers to understand, how are they able to digest this kind of food and make
it. Is it because of the ectomorph body type?
Yeah, that is one thing. But by and large, it is the interaction between the diet and your genetic makeup, or I told you, the molecular fingerprint. That is the one that determines this.
Okay.
I don't know how much you guys are bored with my presentation. In the next few slides, I want to share few examples of my research, which is a little bit probably to provoke your thinking. So I work in the area of diabetes, particularly how when a person has a diabetes, they are likely to develop, you know, some problems. The people with long years of diabetes, they would have problem with eyes, they would have problem with kidneys, they will have problem with even heart or brain. So this we call it as a diabetic complications. As I said, prolonged diabetes leads to complications which mainly affect the eye, kidney, heart, brain, etc. So this is actually main problem for the diabetic people. It's not the glucose that is the problem, because their other organs are affected. I don't know how many of you know, if they are not properly taken care, many of the diabetic people, their feet have to be amputated once it is infected. That is one of the major problems. So here my research is something like this, like you know why these organs get affected when you are a diabetic person. Diabetic means basically your blood glucose levels go up. So glucose, why would our glucose levels go up? Your glucose is regulated by an hormone called, can anyone answer? Once we digest our food, the glucose is produced. That glucose is regulated by an hormone in our body. What is that hormone?
Insulin.
Very good, insulin. So some amount of insulin is required to regulate your glucose, so that that glucose is taken up by the cells for the energy production our day-to-day life. Let us say for some reason or the other, in some people, either this insulin is not produced because the gene that produces insulin may not be there. I'm only giving the hypothetical situations. Or even if that insulin is produced, there is some problem with it in the processing of the insulin, so it doesn't work properly. Therefore, you eat the food is digested, glucose is produced in the blood, but it is not being taken up by the cells. Therefore, the glucose levels go up. So what do you do now? You have to either reduce that glucose levels, or you have to see that your insulin works properly, or you can even think of, because you know you are at the beginning of your career, can I put a gene for insulin and produce more of insulin? Yes, that is one way you can think about it. But if insulin is already produced and it is not working, like you know, there's a kid, he's not studying, and you have to make him to study. So likewise, how do you make this insulin to work? So those are the things one has to think. Anyway, that is the main problem with the glucose, and that affects the many organs. My interest here is that why this high glucose leads to the problem of eyes or kidneys or for that matter nerves. And there's one more simple thing here is that not every diabetic person has this problem. As I said, there are always some deviations. Some people are able to survive with good medication or even otherwise also, whereas some people, even with good medication, they end up with some of these complications. Therefore, my question is, why some people get eye problems, why some people get kidney problems, why some people get heart problems, whereas there are some people who get all these problems also. That is my first question. Why some get all problems, why some get only eye problem? Here common factor is diabetes. Why some get a problem with the kidney, and why some get all three, four problems? So that's what I tell. No, research is curiosity. First you try to understand the address your curiosity, then it may be useful to solve the problem. So when I go back to understand this question, there are some pathways people have already worked. Let's say when you have excess glucose, I think by 9th and 10th you have studied that glucose gets metabolized by this pathway called glycolysis and TCA cycle. But when you have this glucose, when in a normal situation, the amount that can go through this pathways. But in diabetes, you have so much of glucose, and at that time, this pathway cannot take that much. So what happens now? The excess glucose goes into different directions. One of the directions we call it is a pathway, the direction where this glucose is converted to its alcohol form. But in normal conditions, this alcohol will not form. From glucose to its alcohol, we call it as a sorbitol. In normal glucose levels, it will not form. Even if it is formed small amount, it does not make any difference. But when you have excess glucose, this glucose, some amount of glucose becomes its alcohol. That alcohol is a problem in many of the cells, these kidney cells or eye cells. So that is the first understanding. Now, once you understood it, what do you do now if you want to stop the problem to your eye? You know that glucose has become its alcohol form. This is the one which is creating a problem in the eye and the kidney. Now, how do you solve this problem? Can anyone tell me? Simple. How can I stop this conversion of glucose to sorbitol? But before you get to that, first you have to see how this is converted from glucose to its alcohol by an enzyme called aldose reductase. So this enzyme that converts glucose to sorbitol. Now I gave you a clue. How can you stop this conversion? Either you can kill this enzyme, or you can remove this gene. If you don't want to kill, if you don't want to remove, you can use some chemicals which stop functioning of this enzyme. That means you stop functioning of this enzyme so that you will stop the conversion of glucose to sorbitol. Then you may be able to prevent the problem of eye or kidney. I am only giving some example like this. There are different pathways. It's not that this is the only pathway, because I am only trying to see that how best you think of doing the research. Now this is my problem. People have worked on this for many years, that you know, they tried to develop some chemicals or drugs to stop the conversion of glucose to sorbitol, which are going to prevent the function of this enzyme. But for some reason or the other, these chemicals were not so successful at the level of humans. They worked very well in animals, in cell culture and all that. But at the clinical level, there was a lot of failure. And at the beginning of my research, I also decided to see that why, you know, in 30 years or so, people are working in this area, why are not able to solve this problem? Then I took a different approach, because I work at a nutrition institute. I wanted to search some natural sources or natural foods. I know many of you know this one. This is called gooseberry or usirikai in Telugu. So it has got many medicinal properties. Now why I pick up this one is I screened many of the natural sources to see whether any of these have a chemical which can stop the function of this enzyme. So from this natural source, I found a chemical which stops the functioning of this enzyme. That means if I use the chemical from this natural source, I can stop the conversion of glucose to sorbitol. That means maybe that will be useful to prevent the eye problem or kidney problem. So this is all chemistry. I will not bother you by doing, you know, what chemical it has got, how to isolate it. We did all sorts of this chemistry, and then by, you know, different mass spectrometry, and then many other technologies. By finally, we found that chemical to be beta glucogalin. I also want to tell you that earlier to our research, people did not know that this gooseberry has a molecule like this. Many of us know that gooseberry is good for vitamin C. But we are the one, we identified a molecule called glucogalin in gooseberry. I told you that line of pushing the new knowledge. This is what we consider as a new knowledge. Whether it's a big or small, that's a different thing. But the first time in gooseberry, we came to know that there's a molecule called glucogalin. Now I also know that this glucogalin can stop the function of aldose reductase. In other words, it stops the conversion of glucose to sorbitol. So I want to use this for the prevention of eye problem or kidney problem for diabetic people. So like this, I can go on giving many examples. This is your bioinformatics again. So I want to see where this glucogalin is binding to that enzyme. I told you, no, this is aldose reductase. Where is it going to bind? If it is binding, how is it different from the earlier drugs people have identified? If it is the same, then in what way I got a new molecule? No, I got a molecule which is slightly different from the chemicals that earlier people have identified. And later, now I want to, for you kids, because I told you, no, this is the eye lens. I can dissect this eye lens from any animal, either rat or bovine. And when you put the lens on a grid, because it's a transparent one, you can see the lines. Now, I put this lens in a high glucose, something similar to your diabetic condition. I took the lens in a dish, I added a lot of glucose to that dish, and then it became like this. Can you tell me why it has become like this? Because that glucose what I added to this dish is got converted to sorbitol by that enzyme I mentioned, aldose reductase, and that sorbitol accumulated and created osmotic stress and, you know, made this lens like this, opaque. Now I told you I have got a molecule. Now I can put the glucose in this dish. I can also put my glucogalin. Since I have a glucogalin, this glucogalin will not allow the glucose to become sorbitol. So it has stopped the opacity. That means it is keeping the lens as good as, even though I have high glucose here. So these are very simple experiments, though we do in a different way. Once I know that it works, later we actually went to animal models, but I don't want to bother you, where we have added this glucogalin to the diabetic animals, and we see whether it prevents the kidney problem, eye problem. But I want to ask you one question here. Because this research, we cannot do it on humans for ethical reasons. That's why we use some model systems, whether it's cell culture or animal models. Now, I want to study why diabetes causes problem to eye. So, if I want to study that, first I want to create a diabetes in animal model, or for that matter, any model. Now, you tell me, what is the problem in a diabetes? I told you. Now, I want an animal to become diabetic. What should I do? I will take a rat. I want that rat to become diabetes. What you will do?
Sir, we can give it high amount of glucose.
Very good. But you know, I'll tell you, once you give high amount of glucose, the way it gets metabolized, that is regulated. It's the food that gets digested and that gets into the stream of the blood. Yes, that is one way you can give high amount of glucose. But you know, in a natural situation, in our human situation, it's not the problem of taking, because we don't take glucose directly. We take food, that food is digested, and that digested glucose is not absorbed. I want to do something like that in animal, instead of giving high glucose. That is one way. What you said is correct. There are many other ways, because I told you the problem is with the insulin.
Sir?
Yeah?
Sir, we can block that. Block the making of insulin.
Very good. How will you block it?
You got
to the point. How will you block it now? Second step?
By friendling with its production site.
Very good. So insulin is produced by a gland called pancreas, by particular cells called beta cells. So now, if I want to create, there are one or two ways. First thing you said, you can give high glucose, you can give high fat, you can give many, many other things. But coming to the action, that glucose is regulated by insulin. So you have to stop its function, or you have to stop its production. Now what we do, we use a chemical, which that chemical kills the specifically beta cells which produce insulin in that animal. Because if I use a chemical which kills many other cells, that animal will die. I don't want the animal to die. I want the animal to survive, but it should become diabetes. So I use a chemical. That chemical goes and kills the pancreatic cells in beta cells in pancreas. So there is no insulin in the animal. Then there's a lot of glucose in the blood. That animal becomes diabetes. Now I have a diabetic animal. Now I have identified a molecule. I give this molecule to the diabetic animal and see whether its eye is protected, whether kidney is protected. This is how I do the research. Likewise, we have identified a few molecules from different sources. I think I took a lot of your time. So this way we have got some new molecules from gooseberry. We have got a new molecule from cinnamon. We have got a new molecule from pepper. As I told you, when I make this rat diabetic, its eyes become cataract. This is a normal lens, whereas you see the cataract lens, it has become opaque, that I showed you on the grid. So I have a way to capture this. There is a microscope called slit lamp microscope. I use that microscope. For naked eye, it is visible when it is fully matured, but otherwise at early stages, I cannot identify. So I have a microscope to see whether it is transparent or not. Like that, I keep doing that. So there are many other things, like, you know, but later I also want to see whether it is applicable to humans or not. Actually, first of all, why some people are getting eye problem with diabetes, some are not getting. So those who have eye problems with diabetes, their eyes are operated. We go to the, you know, that hospital, we work with the doctors. This is one of the PhD students who work with us. She goes to the operation theater. When they do the operation, she collects the blood, she collects the tissue, comes back to the lab, and we do all analysis whether there is any genetic problem, there is any other problem. That way we identify if there is a mutation in the gene, then we produce that gene in the cells. Okay, that's how now we add new knowledge to the system. I want to share this one last slide and stop it. So while doing this, we have identified a new mutation which leads to a particular eye disease in humans, and that gene name is called ELVLO4. Don't worry, you can call it as ABC gene. That gene is mutated in these animals, these people who have eye problem. Okay. Now we wanted to know, when this ABC gene is mutated, why these people are getting eye problem. So we have cloned this gene. That means you can create a gene in the lab, or you can create animals with a mutation in animals, where you can introduce this mutated gene to the animals at the embryonic stage, and we can produce the animals with a mutated gene. To do that, actually we did this. Actually, I worked in the US for some time for this work. This is a rat pup normally born to the normal rat. Whereas this is the pup that born to the animal which where the, we have mutated this gene. But I want to tell you the story behind this. Actually, we were not able to catch this pup because these rats are nocturnal ones. They are active in the night. And also they have a property, many animals have this property where their kids are abnormal, they eat up them. Many animals, if those offsprings are not good, they eat up them or they kill them and throw into some other place. So therefore, in those animals, we were not able to see the pups. Every day I go to the lab in the morning, I'm not getting the pups for this mutated animal. We did not understand why, you know, this animal is not producing the pups, why it is not producing the pups, though we have mutated the genes, but why they are not getting the pups. For 6 months or so, I think we were going crazy. Then we decided that these are, one day there are one or two pups in the cages, dead pups. At the time I realized that, okay, these pups are born abnormally, that's why the mothers are eating them or they're throwing outside. Then what we decided, we stay in the lab overnight, as and when they born, we picked up them. Okay, you understand how research happens. If we were not very curious why this animal is not producing the animals, I would not have known the function of this gene. Later we came to know that because of the mutation, their skin is a problem. Because of that skin wrinkle and it is not able to grow properly, it is not thermally insulated, so it is dying. The moment it is dead, the mother is eating it up. But if I was not so curious to sit in the overnight in the lab, you know, and then identify it, I would not have known the function of this gene, or for that matter, the group of the people. There are 15-20 people who work together. It's not that I'm only saying myself, but it is a group of 20 people who worked on this. This is how research works many a times, guys. So as I told you, you know, over a period you work with many people, each one comes up with their knowledge, their work, and they add to this knowledge. And this knowledge has been used for different ways for the solution of the problems that we encounter. This is biomedical research. Basically, this is a problem of solving health issues. So there's one more thing. In the research, you also have a benefit of sitting with the people like this, you know, vice president, when you know you get a chance. You can also sit next to the health minister, or sometime even, you know, if you get a chance, you can sit next to a Nobel laureate. You never know, you can sit with anyone else in the world. So it all depends on the opportunity. And as I said, I am very, very happy to work with kids like this. Sometime we go to the schools, we talk to the kids. Okay, I will stop it here. Now you guys can, I stop sharing this slide also.
Thank you, sir.
That was an excellent talk, sir. Thank you so much for your wonderful time and energy. I think, you know, we should first, you know, have a big hand to sir for his, you know, time and energy. Thank you so much, sir. So friends, I think, you know, it's a great honor, you know, to hear Banu sir every time. In fact, you know, every weekend he would spend wonderful time with children, especially with surrounding districts of Hyderabad, Warangal, and Rangareddy. He keeps visiting various schools, especially his alma mater school. And seldom, you know, we find such impressions where, you know, such talks are really taken up at the school level, right from, you know, basic understanding till to the extramural research, you know, that sir has shown, that wonderful, you know, mutational experiment, you know, which is, I believe, in a kind of a breakthrough experiment. So, if you have any quick questions, one or two quick questions, please feel free to ask. Yeah. Hiranyada, Bhavya, Shambhavi, Lakshmi Teja, Shailesh. कोई क्वेश्चन है बेटा आपको, प्लीज.
I don't know because this presentation had some problem. I hope I made it clear to the kids. I was only trying to know, see their thought process because how the research works. As I told you, you have to first think about it. Once you have some knowledge, then how can you add to that knowledge? As some of the kids were very, very good. I said, how do you make an animal diabetic? Somebody said, you give a lot of glucose, that's good. Or you stop the functioning of insulin, that is good. That means, you know, I don't know if I were at your age, I would have got that kind of thought. But you guys are excellent.
Yeah. No, well said, sir. Yeah. So friends, can we all switch on our web camera,
yes,
you know, for
yes.
a quick photograph? You know, this is a kind of a rare opportunity, I would say. Yeah.
Bothering your questions, I enjoyed. Very good.
Yeah, Shailesh asked, you know, wonderful questions. Yeah. Yeah, 1 minute, please. I'm just, you know, I've taken one screenshot earlier. I just want to paste that earlier, you know, in a different screen. Just give me 1 minute, please. I'm sorry. Yeah.
Am I visible?
Yes, yes, yes. 1 minute, please. Huh? Yeah.
I hope you kids liked it and it is somewhat useful.
I bothered you with so many questions.
No, absolutely not. No, I enjoyed it.
Thank you, sir, for such an interesting and wonderful talk.
Yes, no, Bhavya, thank you.
Yeah, 1 minute, sir. I'm just, 1 minute. Yes, I think everyone is on the screen. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Yeah. Yes, say cheese. Yeah. Lakshmi Teja.
Yeah.
Beta, can you please switch on your camera if you have? Yeah.
Plus, you have to cover completely. You are.
Oh, sorry, sir. My camera is not that great, sir. I'll try to. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, now you are there.
Yeah. So say cheese. Yes. Yeah. 1 minute. Yeah. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much, sir, for your time. Yeah. Thank you. Yeah. Thank you very much, sir.
Yeah.
So, friends,
thanks.
Please, you know, please feel free to talk
thank
to
you,
sir. He's also in the group.
Yeah.
And please ensure.
Thank you for your guidance.
Please ensure that, you know, you keep asking questions. You know, it's a kind of a good opportunity. And if you're above 16 years and if you have a Facebook account, please follow sir as well. Yeah. 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 Thank you so much. Thank you, sir. Thank
thanks.
You.
Thanks.
Yeah, thank
thanks,
you very
thanks
much.
Guys. All the best. Good luck.
Thank you, sir, for having a wonderful talk.